Boa tarde a todos. Muito obrigado pela vossa presença nesta sessão de encerramento do 9º Festival Literário de Macau. Um agradecimento a todos os presentes, a todas as pessoas que nos apoiaram nesta edição do festival. Um agradecimento particular a Mo Kin-hin, presidente do Instituto Cultural, não só porque o Instituto Cultural, de facto, tem apoiado o festival desde o primeiro momento, mas também porque são, no fundo, anfitriões aqui, dado que este é um espaço belíssimo que está sob a tutela do Instituto Cultural de Macau. E tivemos cá, já no ano passado, uma edição do festival que correu muito bem e este ano tivemos de novo a oportunidade de usar este espaço.
We have the opportunity to use this space today. So thank you to the Institute, the Cultural Institute, and all of the sponsors to help bring this festival. So even in the situation of the pandemic, all the institutes that were still willing to help and support us. The festival has also to do with celebrating the commemorating the 10th anniversary of the passing of Henrique de Sena Fernandes, who was born in 1923 as one of 11 siblings to an old Macanese family who settled in Macau over 250 years ago. He studied law at the University of Coimbra before becoming a writer. Besides writing, he was a teacher and director at the Pedro Nolasco Commercial School. In 2006, he received an honorary doctorate from the University of Macau and Medal of Cultural Merit in 2001. We will now be remembering Henrique de Sena Fernandes through a video.
Uma das coisas bonitas da vida de Ribeiro era, agora não, às 5, 6 horas, ao cair da noite, antes disso, à tarde ainda estava muito sol, mas já com a tarde avançada, era o passeio das meninas, estes anos 50, das bailarinas que sentávamos nos triciclos e que outro tipo de mulher, mas muito elegantes, com aqueles chonzan, sentávamos no triciclo e subiam e desciam à Avenida Almeida Ribeiro. Não há para mim um vestido feminino mais bonito do que o chonzan, que torna uma mulher naturalmente elegante, porque o próprio vestido aperta e ela não tem movimentos assim frouxos, se está sempre direita, com gestos dados até mover a cabeça, justamente por causa do vestido e da gola alta, não é? Que tinha. De maneira que eram naturalmente elegantes, não é? Eram naturalmente elegantes, não é? E depois como a racha no vestido, não é? Mostravam a coxa, umas mais ousadas, outras menos ousadas, mas de qualquer maneira era um atrativo excelente e lúbrico, quase lúbrico para os homens, embora elas nunca me provocassem nem nada, andavam conversando entre elas e tal, iam fazendo uma parada. Isto era um dos grandes atrativos do Macau antes da nova companhia, antes do STDM ter transferido para o Hotel Estoril, ali no Tapsiá, e depois acabada a construção do Hotel Lisboa.
Thank you. The leaves of brown came tumbling down, remember, in September. In the rain, that old sun went out just like a dying ember. That September in the cold, cold rain. To every word of love I heard you whisper, the raindrops seemed to play a sweet refrain. Oh, spring is here to me, it's still September.
Forget the moment we kissed the night of the hayride, the way that we hugged to try to keep warm while taking a sleigh ride.
Magic moments, memories we've been sharing. Magic moments when two hearts are caring. Time can't erase the memory of these magic moments.
entre 10 e 15 anos, não é? Tive um caso com uma aqui no escritório e a pessoa que veio me pôr era uma moça muito bonita e com quem me familiarizei muito bem. E fiz esse favor e ela disse-me um dia, veio com uma caixa e disse: isto é para ti, pelos favores, enfim, pela amizade, etc, 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 etc. Toma lá. Eu fiquei assim espantado e abri e vi este relógio. Olha, eu fiquei assim. Eu agradeço muito, mas eu não posso usar este relógio. Ela ficou espantada assim, mas porquê? Como eu vou explicar à minha mulher a existência deste relógio? Por mais explicações que eu dê, ela não vai aceitar, também vai haverá complicações, eu não posso. E depois, eu disse, o melhor que tens a fazer. Ela ficou muito, muito ofendida. É uma coisa que eu te dou e se isso não era preciso, tu tens já a minha amizade e não é preciso mais nada. Eu estou reconhecido pelos meus trabalhos, eu estou reconhecido pela tua amizade, etc, etc, etc. Tu guarda, eu fico sempre com a lembrança do relógio, mas eu não posso aceitar este relógio. E ela está bem. Ela olhou assim para mim e disse: eu guardo. E eu também não vou utilizá-lo. E eu disse: dei para uma pessoa. E portanto, bom, ela levou. Não ficou zangada comigo, nada disto. E se passam-se 10, 12 anos. E morreu minha mulher. Passado os meses, alguma coisa, aparece ela com a caixa. Olha, eu guardei estes anos todos no relógio. Isto é teu. Cá está. É uma história bonita, não é? É uma história bonita, parece. Cá está, eu ando com esse relógio e muito contente até.
O nosso obrigado ao Miguel, ao Felipe e a toda a família Sena Fernandes.
Thank you to Miguel and also his family for sharing all these documents and photos with us. And before commencing the session, there is the option of simultaneous translation.
Passo então a apresentar os nossos convidados.
We will now go ahead and introduce our distinguished guests. The first will be Miguel de Sena Fernandes. Welcome, Miguel de Sena Fernandes. And I feel that I don't even need to do any introduction for these people because they are well known in Macau. But we will still give a small introduction of their background and their work. Miguel de Sena Fernandes is a lawyer by profession. He's also a playwright, director, and linguist dedicated to preserving the Macanese culture. As a founding member of Dosi Papiasa in Dimacau, Sena Fernandes has written a number of plays in Patois since the group's stage debut in 1993. We also have Carlos Moreiros. Carlos Moreiros is an award-winning architect, urban planner, designer, and artist. Born in Macau, he studied here in Portugal, Germany, and Sweden before returning to Macau in 1983. He is regularly invited to exhibit and lecture at galleries and universities in Europe, America, and Asia. He's also a university professor and community leader, serving in many non-governmental organizations and governmental communities. Carlos Moreiros is the founder and partner of Albergue SCM. Which at the moment is also organizing an exhibition of art, female art. Other distinguished guests are Carlos Frota. Welcome. Carlos Frota is a diplomat, scholar, and poet. Carlos Frota was the first Consul General of Portugal in Macau shortly after the transfer of administration in Macau on the 20th of December 1999. He also represented Portugal in South Korea and Indonesia. He teaches at the University of St. Joseph and is the author of three poetry books. The most recent, A Culpa é das Estrelas, Guilt Rests with the Stars, was published last year. And now we have, coming all the way from UK, David Brookshaw, a professor emeritus at the University of Bristol. He has published widely in the field of Brazilian and Lusophone post-colonial studies and has also translated the work of various Portuguese authors, including Mio Couto, Paulina Chizane, João Paulo Borges Coelho, and Henrique de Sena Fernandes. He has also organized anthologies of the American short stories of the Portuguese writers, José Rodrigues Migueiras, as well as a collection of stories by writers based in or from Macau, under the title Visions of Macau, Stories from Macau, containing examples of the short fiction of Diolinda de Conceição, Sena Fernandes, Fernanda Dias, and Maria Odina Braga. The Archive of Confessions is the first work he has translated by the Macau-based author Carlos Moraes Zuzé. And coming from Hong Kong, we have Chris Song. He helped David Bradshaw translate the work. He translated the book of David Bradshaw from English to Chinese. He is a poet, translator, and editor based in Hong Kong. He's published four collections of poetry and many volumes of poetry in translation. He has been invited to international literary and poetry festivals in Berlin, Taipei, Bangkok, Hanoi, and Hong Kong, among others. Song received an extraordinary mention at Italy's UNESCO Reorganized Nocide World Poetry Prize in 2013. More recently, he won the Young Artist Award at the 2017 Hong Kong Art Developments Award. In 2018, he obtained a PhD in Translation Studies from Lingguan University. Song is now an executive director of the Hong Kong International Poetry Nights and editor-in-chief of Voice and Verse Poetry Magazine. And finally, we have Carlos Moraes José. Carlos Moraes José was born in Lisbon. In November of 1963, having earned a degree in anthropology, he relocated in 1990 to Macau, where he resides to this day. He's worked in journalism, advertising, and publishing, and is currently a director of the newspaper Ocean Macau and the head of a publishing firm. The Archive of Confessions, in the original Portuguese edition of 2016, is 10th in a line of books that he has authored, all published in Portuguese, alongside others in genre include poetry, chronicle, and comic strips. So now we have done all the introductions to our distinguished guests, and we will now commence the session. The books from these authors have all been translated into English and Portuguese, but we will be conducting the session in Portuguese. Sena Fernandes wrote most of his books in Portuguese. So now we will also be doing the session in Portuguese with an English and Chinese translation. From now we will have a reading of an excerpt of the book from Henrique de Sena Fernandes by Joana Chantre.
Achan, the boatwoman. Achan was not a native of the inner harbor. She had a confused memory of her childhood, the gray village lost somewhere in the delta. Few recollections stuck in her consciousness. Buffalo grazing in the yellow marshlands. Men, possibly relatives of hers, bent double, cultivating an unforgiving soil. A pagoda. Perched on top of some high ground, shaven-headed priests in mournful pageantry. Trafficked through the countryside during a year of terrible drought, when she was barely six, she had been passed from hand to hand until she had reached the mouth of the river with the old woman, who had bought her from a wealthy patron at Siaki. It had been a good piece of business for the elderly Tanka woman, for in those days it was impossible to acquire a Muay Chai for such a bargain price. But for Achan, the transaction was like a gift from the gods. The old woman took her to the very tip of the delta, to the white city of the Portuguese, and set her to work on that stretch of river known as the Inner Harbor. In the beginning, her tasks were hard, exhausting, giving her skinny physique as an apprentice boatwoman. But her health triumphed, and she soon adapted to her adventurous existence. The old woman treated her harshly and would beat her repeatedly. But deep down, she preferred this treatment to that received from her aristocratic masters, for the old woman was less cruel, and her life was full of variety. After a few months as an apprentice, she was an expert at her job. She could steer the sampan with a sure hand as it wandered the waters of the river, and she knew how to dodge with lightning swiftness the currents and the threat of other vessels as they approached. No one would guess, upon seeing her rowing, her boat weighted down with goods and passengers, that she had come from some remote village and that she had been acquired as a Muay Chai by the self-seeking, but at heart, generous old woman. Life on the river was anything but carefree. The struggle for a bowl of rice was the cause of harrowing tears, and all the women were familiar with the harsh effects of their profession. However, Achan, although she had no love for the river or the old woman, preferred them to the aristocratic house, where her enslavement had been more painful.
Dan家女,阿珍,阿珍不是土生土长的来港人。 他对童年的记忆很模糊，或者是在三角洲上一个不知名的村落里面度过吧。他的脑海里面自残留着一些模拟的记忆。有水牛在湿地上面食草，有几个男人或者是他的亲戚，在一片无情的土地上面弯腰俯身埋头耕作。一座佛塔坐落在山岗上。 葬礼上面有几个秃头的和尚，时逢寒年，他刚刚满六岁就被拐卖到乡下，买主一个换一个， 直到三角洲有个疍家老太太在一个石岐里的贵妇手上将她买了过来。对疍家老太太来说，这个是一笔不错的买卖，在那些日子里面不可能以这么低的价格买到一个妹仔的。对阿珍来说，这笔交易亦都是天赐给她的。疍家老太太将阿珍带到三角洲末端的一个城市，这个城市属于葡国的白人。老太太被她在称为内港的地方里面工作，刚刚开始的时候做得很吃力，做到她筋疲力尽。她学做疍家女，身子太瘦弱了，但是身体还挺健康，令到她渡过了难关，适应了充满冒险的历程。老太太对她很苛刻，经常打她，但是她心里面觉得被她打好过被个贵妇打啦。那个老太太没她那么残暴，生活也都比较精彩。短短数个月，她进步神速，已经可以充满信心地在海流水域上面控制舢板，也都懂得以迅雷之势避开那些正在靠近的水流或者其他的船只。看到她稳当地划船，船上面还载着些沉甸甸的货物和船客，冇人会想到她是来自遥远的乡下，亦都冇人会想到她是那个表面自私但是内心慷慨的疍家老太太买来的妹仔。船上的生活无忧无虑，几多的眼泪只是换来一碗饭。女人都知道做事的艰辛，虽然阿珍不喜欢海水，亦都不喜欢那个疍家老太太，但是她宁愿这样，因为以往在富家大宅里面做奴婢更加痛苦。
Obrigado. Obrigado, Alice. Obrigado, Joana.
Thank you, Alice, and also thank you, Joana, for the reading. Nam Van Tales of Macau has now been released in English and Chinese. Now we'll be starting with Miguel. We had the opportunity to watch the film, the beautiful film about your father. And you were the one who wrote the preface for your father's book and you must have many memories from your father. What do you remember the most? First, let's have, I will talk a bit about the film. It was made. He passed away in my brother Philippe. We worked together on this and we put together the images. So we used the footage from Lucia and we put together this film. This film, before everything, Sir Henry. Is inspiration to Carlos Moraes.
Sir Henry. Mas aproveitava também para dizer que isto são, é uma interpretação da vida.
It's an interpretation of the life of Henrique Sena Fernandes. There's many things that are not there.
Não está aqui a cruz, qualquer referência a toda a vida privada dele.
It's a reference, of course, there are many details of his private life that his friends know. That Henrique Sena Fernandes, when he passed away, he had another wife. She is not here at this moment, and she's not represented here. But this is not important. In out of respect to my father, we're not interfering with any of his personal matters. It's been many years. So no matter what, we have a great respect for him. And this is not any cause to...
The talks?
So these are just more things that we can chit-chat about. At this time, when we started having these kind of talks with him, is when I returned to Portugal. When I returned from Portugal, I was already a lawyer. And we're already among the great people of the society. And in these moments of chit-chat over whiskey and conversing, at that time I didn't drink whiskey, but I learned how to drink whiskey with him. And that was our happy hour. After 6, he would come and pick me up and with his wife, and we would have talks together. And this is how I also got to discover many things about him. He would tell stories within stories, and this was a way that I was able to discover him as a man, and also discover his sensibility that he had in relation to life and situations. Especially things that he wrote about. He would write about people that he knew and people that we knew. We knew about this. Whenever he would meet a beautiful girl, he would think of a beautiful story about her. And his favorite phrase was, "Isn't this a beautiful story?" This was something about him. And with all of this, we learned a lot about him. He obviously was senior to me and had many years ahead of me. But he was not someone to say, "Son, let me teach you such and such." We were more like buddies. And in these moments, the man that I discovered was a lot more than the man I knew as a father. He was a man and had many defaults that all men have and all the qualities that he had. He was human. With all the problems, one of the main problems he had was his way of communication. He would say, "Oh, I think I have talked a lot today." But he always told a beautiful story, and he was very happy when he told a beautiful story. But he had a lot going on in his head, and he wanted to say all of it at once. So he often talked a lot. But it was in these moments that we got to know more about his work and his heroes and heroines that he created in his stories. I use the word hero, but not in the meaning of being male or female, but just the fundamental figure that exists in a work. At the end of the day, it's a woman. That's the basis of everything. And to be able to understand his work, the fundamentality of his work, and besides so much that is talked about today about feminism, in this way, he was quite pro-feminism, which was quite uncommon at the time. His writings were mainly, his point of view was women, though, that they were not necessarily perfect. and not always perfectly beautiful. In fact, one of the characters, Achen, was not very beautiful at all, was ugly. And it wasn't the typical story about the stereotyped beauty that we know. Physically, she had her defects, but the description and her life and the situations and context that she was placed in, you discovered a lot of beauty in this woman. And this is very fundamental. In the film about your father, we see him with a lot of influential members of the Macau society. But many of the characters in his story were quite normal and low-class people. Do you think this was part of his character to be more close to people of the lower, the normal class? Yes, my father knew many of the powerful members of Macau society, but he also got along with more humble people. The richness of his day, of his books, probably come from this, from the fact that he lived with everyone. He was very comfortable talking with someone from the government, and he was also very comfortable having a beer with from someone that he grew up with or someone he hadn't seen for many years. So he had this capacity that probably not everyone has to be able to be with people from all walks and all classes of life. And that's it. And importantly, all of this became something that made his work possible in great depth in terms of its humanity, the descriptions and the context that he put in the story, and a very rich piece of work. Macau only has to gain with the work that he made, besides the point of him being my father. Let's talk a little bit about how he was able to be a lawyer and a writer, which is something not easy because this is a lot of things at the same time, but we'll pass it on to Carlos Mujeres, which in the 60s was one of the fundamental people encouraging the publishing of the works of Henriksen and Fernandes. Let's talk a little bit about your effort and how influential you were to helping these works get published. I want to say hi to our colleagues in Hong Kong and in Lisboa and in Bristol. I also brought the first Amor de Dinhos e Pés, the first book, the first edition from. I would like everyone to be happier today. Sir Henry. This name came about when I had an official visit to London. It was a fantastic story because.
Mas gabiru, não galo dodo, na nossa língua.
This is a patois word.
To help the translator, galo dodo means a mad rooster.
A mad rooster.
A protector of girls. No. No. In Guangdong, né?
It's a mad chicken.
Era um gabiru, não do estilo galo dodo. E acho que já ajudei os tradutores. Depois eu mando a fatura.
Portanto,
ele era um.
He was a mad chicken.
Também não Giacomo Casanoviano, Casanova. Ele era um doce gabiru.
He was a sort of Casanova.
De um friso botticelliano.
He was very interested in beautiful women, always surrounded by beautiful women. He dressed very well.
Henrique
Sena Fernandes. He was a very kind person. When we would meet him and have conversation with him, we would talk about football. Or in any type of inauguration ceremony. He always had to have words and with the beautiful women. Besides, it didn't matter how they looked. When they were with him, they would always feel like they were very beautiful women. You know about the spicy stories that he would talk about in his stories. This is a character from his books, in From the Amor de
Despejos.
He was very... When he was drunk, he would talk about the different stories and the different adventures that he had had with women, and Henrique would note it down. He didn't like so much intellectual conversations or existential topics. Or people that were very knowledgeable. He didn't care much about this kind of knowledge. He wanted people to tell him about flowers. There was a fire in his office in San Malo. He had an archive with books from the poet Fernando Pessoa and other literary texts. He always told me about this character, the Pai de Orquídeas. Always surrounded by women. But it was never edited or released to the public. He talked about the dancers that would go up and down the San Malo. And that was seemed like their eyes were filled with fireworks. They were very happy every time they would look at him. The first time he heard about a word, lupanar, it was about a brothel and a lot of celebrities from Portugal, the names that we will not share, that would visit this brothel. The poetry.
And he's talking about flowers.
The poetry talked about flowers, but they were not really talking about flowers. They were actually talking about the girls in the brothels. They used some very particular Macanese terms. These women were the ones that would play the Chinese traditional instrument pipa, which the instrument itself had the shape of a woman. And they would play these instruments to entertain their clients. These women were not prostitutes. They were entertainers. They were hosts. And they would be sold for very high prices to rich men who wanted to marry them. And they could be the first concubine or even a wife. In town. So they were called the pipa women. In the years of the 20s, the 30s, and the 40s, it was not a secret that men would go to the Happiness Street and enjoy the company of the pipa women. Nobody remembers the question that I put forward. I would like to call attention to the edition of the book of Carlos Moreiras, and which we have editions of them for sale here at the book fair, and also the design by
Carlos Frota, amigo pessoal de Henrique Sena Fernandes, também tem
Carlos Frota, which is a
private friend
of Henrique Sena Fernandes. I'm sure you have great you miss him terribly. Could you tell us a few words about your friend? I have a small remark to make, which is my contribution to the homenage for Henrique. Miguel knows that I'm very sincere, and I had previously contact with Miguel about this film that you organized together with his family, because it really brought me back to an ambient that I knew very well. And I'm certain that my wife is also in agreement with me on this feeling, because this is such an exceptional moment that we passed together with other friends here in Macau. Henrique Sena Fernandes represents for us something that transcends our personal friendship, and that I try to interpret into a letter that I wrote for him, that I, and I titled it "A Letter for My Friend Who Is Not Present Anymore." And I have this letter here in my iPad. A letter to my friend, my absent friend. My dear Henrique Sena Fernandes, my distinguished and dear friend, I treat you ceremoniously before I treat you as a family, because the first time I met you was a ceremony. Do you remember in that afternoon in October in 1996, I went up the stairs to your old office in the San Malo to visit the representative of the Portuguese community here in Macau. I could never imagine that this would be the first moment of a great, deep friendship. Me and my wife, 14 years, this is a landmark moment. I came into your office timidly, and I found a man who was not just a lawyer, but also a writer and a master of storytelling. And this quality, I could finish here, but I would like to continue the stories and memories.
Encarregado da missão específica de organizar o futuro consulado, que depois da transferência,
after
Portugal,
I was the one responsible for organizing with the Portuguese consulate after the transfer back to China. His reaction was very happy. A Portuguese consulate here in Macau? I was the one who had to teach millions of children. In this moment, for other diplomats, it would be a strange moment. But this is when I started to feel that we were compatriots. We had similar life stories. And we had similar views. I told him about my birth land. We were a young couple. We had just graduated. We had what most young people have the best, the ability to dream and the capacity to finish and go for our dreams. And most of our conversations talked about the similarities that we had and also promises that we had for the future. I was so impressed by his way of dealing with me and also with the community here in Macau. I was curious and I wanted to live moments that he was writing about in his stories. What he had from 2 decades of experience. I also wanted to redeem myself of the fact that I was in a land that was not my birthland, and he was my friend and my confidant. And in the following days, I started reading his works. I started to respect him even more, and the memory is very clear of the story Macau Macaense, which is the Macau Portuguese, which links with the Chinese culture. It dispersed to very few other cultures. You can imagine the lovers in the San Francisco garden. You can imagine the girl with the braid. And like this, I was guided by you, my dear friend Henrique. I was able to also maintain an idea of the Macanese culture and have an identity of the Macanese. But it was enriching. It was mutually enriching relationship. This ability that people have to live together and to overcome all the complex issues. And the difference and the joining together of different cultures. These are fragments of a memory. There are so many in this letter that I wrote. I was going to the Consul General on the 1st of January to wish him a Happy New Year. And you remember what I told you?
How about we turn
this into an opportunity to have a lunch together between friends, our first lunch together as friends. And that's what happened. A few days after, the first of many lunches that we would have together that would happen over the course of many years. And your house in Taipa, and friends were always received with such kindness and warmth. And also the festivities that would happen on the new year. And we talked about friendship. And we got together with other people within the Macanese culture. And the amazing Macanese food and drinks. And other friends that we would have festivities together with. And the consulate not having any more money.
Before I finished my time as a consul, my friend would like to invite me.
A tarefa era redundante. Henrique Sena Fernandes não precisava de apresentação, muito menos.
Henrique Sena Fernandes needs no introduction, but I feel so content that I was able to introduce him to you. And I really miss the talks with him because it was a privilege to talk with someone like him. I remember so many times we spent in Bella Vista. His way of appreciating and describing people. The memories that he had of so many parties and meetings. And building roots to people, the local people. And our destiny as a family. For another, there's three things that I ended up leaving Macau, but three things that I would like to remember about him. I'm thankful for his friendship. I'm thankful for his poetry. And his books with the beautiful illustrations from the Carlos Mojeros. I still remember going to events in the Clube Militar and the Teatro Dom Pedro and I would like to keep this illusion that we're not closing before time the window of a memory
and it's from his dear
Macau and it's from dear Macau that we should look out at the world. And we went to visit another writer after years passed. But our friendship didn't suffer. The time had only enriched our friendship. The heart has many ways to express itself. I can either finish this letter.
I would like to thank
Miguel
for his new book.
He deserves this moment as the son of Henrique Sena Fernandes.
His father always talked to me about you so much.
Your father always talked to me with such affection about you. Until see you soon, my friend.
Pediria à minha mulher o favor de ler um poema que escrevi e aqui intitulei No Jardim de São Francisco e que vem publicado no meu último livro, justamente, Dos Rios e Suas Margens. Faz o favor, Lina.
Yes. De Carlos Frota, um poema em homenagem a Henrique Sena Fernandes, do livro Dos Rios e Suas Margens, Macau, 1998. no Jardim de São Francisco. Numa tarde serena e ociosa, embrenho-me pensativo pelo jardim, procurando ouvir as histórias que me quer contar o tronco silencioso da velha árvore frondosa. De repente, pressinto dois vultos de jovens namorados, ternamente enlaçados. Ele, meio oculto, meio envergonhado, ela, muito bela, de uma beleza trigueira. E então pressinto que ela é a jovem da trança feiticeira.
Muito obrigado a ambos. E vamos então passar aos nossos convidados no exterior. E a começar pelo David Brookshaw, autor da tradução de Namvane Contos de Macau. Antes tinha já traduzido A Trança Feiticeira. Esteve cá também no ano passado, no Festival Literário de Macau, nessa altura, para apresentar a tradução do romance do Carlos Moraes José, O Arquivo das Confissões. Espero, David, que me esteja a ouvir.
Sim.
E gostava já agora que começasse por explicar, enfim, à plateia como é que começou esta sua ligação à obra do Henrique de Sena Fernandes, que o levou, por exemplo, a escrever um estudo que chamou Imperial Diaspora and the Search of Authenticity, The Mechanist Fiction of Henrique de Sena Fernandes. Portanto, é muito mais do que tratador, é um estudioso da obra do Henrique Sena Fernandes. Como é que começou essa ligação?
David is much more than just a translator, but he's an expert to the works of Henrique Sena Fernandes. So this all started from the first time I went to Macau in 1966, if I'm not mistaken. Me and my wife went to visit our daughter that was in Australia, and we stopped by in Macau. I went inside the Portuguese bookstore. I used to study Portuguese, Brazilian Portuguese, and I studied as well many works of African Portuguese-speaking countries in Africa, and I was always very curious about the works here of the Portuguese from Macau. And at the time in the bookstore, there was a section with the authors from Macau. I had heard about Henrique Sena Fernandes, if I'm not mistaken, because at that time in Portugal there used to be a certain interest of works of literature from Macau, perhaps as a way to try to make people think about Portuguese continue to be a literary language after the transfer. The Macau handover to China. I ended up buying a book in the Portuguese bookshop. It was The Bewitching Braid. And then I ended up leaving and I went to Australia and I read the book. I read this romance. And I thought it was an amazing story. Afterwards, I thought, I think that I had read Orientalism from Edward Said. And I asked myself, is there an Orientalism of the Portuguese language? And therefore, after that, I decided to study China, but seen from the eyes of the Portuguese literature. And then obviously what came in the question, the issue of the literature in Portuguese from Macau. After that, I started reading even more books from Henrique Sena Fernandes, including Amor e Dedinhos de Pés. And then I ended up visiting Macau again as someone 1994, and I met Henrique Sena Fernandes at that time. And then my familiarity with his works ended up having me get to know other writers that write in Portuguese. And I ended up making a study that was published in English, and it was called Perceptions of China. in modern Portuguese literature. And there was like an academic book around these areas, Macau areas. But I always ended up with an interest of the literature in Macau. And it was as part of this study that I ended up organizing an anthology of Contos de Macau, which is stories about Macau. And they were published, these works were published as well. And this anthology was published by Gavia Brown, which is a publisher in the US. But the, a publisher in Hong Kong ended up manifesting an interest, and they ended up being published together with this publisher in Hong Kong and the Hong Kong University Press, that ended up showing interest in publishing the book The Bewitching Braid in English translation. And then, of course, I continue with this project from, that ended up being published in 2004. I think I talk through everybody to say that everybody thanks you for having translated this, because David, you have been an essential part of the translation of on the publishing of Henrique's books. Did you have any issues translating his works? Did you feel any compared to other works that you had translated in Portuguese language? Well, the difficulties were the way that he used to write, Henrique de Sena Fernandes. I would say that his writing is quite simple, straightforward, in the sense that there's no experimentalism or any difficult words that other other writers use in Portuguese Africa or in other countries. The important thing is to maintain the vivacity and the mood of his dialogue, and all of his lyrical passages. Would be when he would stop to describe a scenery, would be quite simple. I guess the difficult part, for example, in the Bewitching Braids, would be some sayings from the Macanese culture, maybe in Patois, that it's necessary some certain type of interpretation. I have an example, for example, in the book Candy. I think you all know that Candy is about a romance between a Macanese man and a person from Hong Kong. That afterwards she ends up marrying with a rich English from Hong Kong, from the English administration in Hong Kong. After a certain time, they end up meeting again after being apart for 24 years. After he goes back to Hong Kong, they end up meeting again in the Star Ferry in Hong Kong. And he was just so impressed by the English that she speaks. Perfect English. She spoke as perfect English. She did not have a Macanese style of English. Yeah, the Macanese talk in a very exaggerated way. And she had a perfect English. She spoke with a British accent, and she said toast, right, like the English say. So this was easier to translate. I try to keep the original terms because I feel like you can understand it from the general feel of the book. Certain, I directly translated some of the words from Chinese. In one of the works, the fishing in the waters around Macau, there was an issue with the fish. Because I had experience from the past year, because I had translated a book, a travel book from Raul Brandão, As Ilhas Desconhecidas, The Unknown Islands, which was from the Açores, located in the Açores. There's full of fish over there. And I managed to, from the internet helped a lot. I managed to find a Norway dictionary. A dictionary talking about fish. Um dicionário da Suécia a falar. There was an old friend of mine called Nairo. So the names of the streets, for example, and the references from Macau, I wrote it in Portuguese as they were written. I didn't translate it because I feel that there's this issue with the translators, whether you should translate them or not, especially the translators that deal with works that are post-colonial. Why should we? I mean, there's an issue about should we translate everything or should we leave certain words as they are? Like, should I? Should I change the words for the readers, or should I leave them as they are? I try to go halfway, to mix the words. But in terms of the places, of the names of the street, I keep them in Portugal, in Portuguese. So there's a lot of challenges there, and I kept a lot of names of the streets because the Macanese culture is a result between a meeting between a way of being Portuguese and a culture of the south of southern China. And nowadays, these cultures, there's a lot of pressure in these cultures, you know, because of the big Mandarin and because of English. So there's a danger of losing the peculiarities of these two cultures. I would like to ask these same questions to Chris Song, which is a translator, a Chinese translator of the book. Welcome, Chris, for being with us from Hong Kong.
An author from Macau. And I'm sure that you had to familiarize yourself with Macau and its people and its customs. How difficult was it and how pleasant it was for you to do this work? No, we are not being able to listen to you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, yes. Please.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, I'd like to thank the organizer, Ricardo, for the honor to join this event today and for the opportunity to translate this important collection of stories into Chinese. In translating Nam Van, I did learn a great deal about the Lusophone life and experience in Macau. Although I lived in Macau for about 8 years previously, I was, in fact, particularly attracted to the stories that set before and after the Second World War. The war had changed many characters' courses of life, for the better or for the worse, not just as a part of the twist or plot line of the story itself, but also a deeper and more symbolic level that made me think about the issue of identity, which is so relevant to our contemporary world, maybe not just in Macau or Hong Kong, and also in many parts of the world. In Mr. Fernandez's stories, for example, in the tea with essence of cherry, Mauricio's mysterious business trip to China that made him very rich, and he then was able to further his post-war pursuit for fortune and happiness. And also in Candy, the heroine gives her newborn Macau Portuguese daughter to a Chinese couple in Guangzhou and loses her forever. And it seems that Mr. Fernandez were extremely interested in exploring the various issues of the Macau Portuguese identity in this largely Chinese context, geographically speaking. And it makes me think of a lot of the modern Chinese fiction that I've read in the past. They were all, if they were about the war or set in the background of the war in the last century, the Chinese identity issue is often tinged with the nation-building color or remains largely unquestionable after the nation was built in 1949. But I think Mr. Fernandez's stories being free from the Chinese nation-building myth shows Sinophone readers like me a very fresh perspectives to the issue of identity and allow me to reflect on such issues that I'm also dealing with today. I think I can also speak for many ethnically Chinese people living in Hong Kong and Macau. And in these two stories that I just mentioned, Mauricio's, like the characters in the tea with essence of cherry, this character marries a Chinese woman and happily lives in Japan ever after. And Candy laments her decision of giving up her Macau Portuguese daughter to the Chinese and is forever confined, sadly, to an English household in Hong Kong. And I think we can discern Mr. Fernandez's care about the Macau Portuguese heritage and where it goes, a question like that. And likewise, and the ethnic Chinese people in Macau and Hong Kong are also faced with this effacing of our identities, I think. And by reading Mr. Fernandez's stories, I think Sinophone readers like me surely have a lot to digest and think about in today's context.
Yeah, precisely. That it's not often that local writers in Portuguese are translated into Chinese. How do you anticipate that this book will be received by Chinese readers, namely in Hong Kong?
Yeah, that also made me think about the issue of translation in Hong Kong and Macau. For me, translation is like a bridge making among different cultures. It allows us to learn from each other, right? We often think about translation as transnational, but it is at first transcultural, I think. In Macau, we have Chinese and Portuguese literatures. In Hong Kong, we have Chinese and English literatures. and possibly also literatures written in other languages. But similar is the language barrier in the intra-regional communication, I think. We must not overestimate the bilingual proficiency in both cities, although we recognize the different languages as our official languages, but the bilingual proficiency is questionable. Without the appreciation of each other's literature, the mutual understanding would be very superficial and limited, I think. So intra-regional translation within a multi-linguistic region is often neglected in our cities. But it is in fact extremely important if we want to understand ourselves better. And that's why I feel particularly glad to translate Mr. Fernandez's books into Chinese. And the festival is doing very important work for the local cultural communities. And I hope that more and more such translations will be available in the future in both Macau and Hong Kong.
And we cannot thank you enough, Chris, for accepting to do this job. Thank you so much. I will ask you to stay a little bit more. Maybe in a few minutes, the audience would like to ask you any question. And Carlos, bem-vindo também. Tivemos no ano passado o Chris aqui.
Carlos, thank you. Welcome. We had Chris here last year talking about translation. We also had your book translated, a romance. We hope that it could also be translated to Chinese. Relatively to this translation of Henrique Sena Fernandes, can you tell me what's the importance that you give to this type of work? Good afternoon to everybody in Macau. I would like to say congratulations to this script road. Because of the pandemic, I bet that it was a challenge to make it happen. Everything happens in such a difficult way, so congratulations, Ricardo, and the whole team for being able to come up with the script road this year. So, answering your question, the translation. I feel like Chris in Hong Kong has said a lot. Chris has explained to us that it's necessary in Macau and in Hong Kong to be more communication between the communities because our visions are different, and but they help each other. Chris feels like he learned a lot with this mechanist vision of Henrique Sena Fernandes. He needed to understand the cultural aspects in Macau to make a good translation. He needed to know about his own identity because people from Macau, Chinese from Macau and from Hong Kong, have different identities. And these identities, of course, have a lot to do because of their colonial pasts. Sometimes this goes so much farther than what it seems. There is a certain distance between the communities. There is a big distance between the two communities. There is an ignorance in what has to do with the language, obviously. In Macau, we're very lucky that we have the Macanese culture that actually are a bridge between the Portuguese culture and the Chinese culture. But besides that, besides the language, in Macau, we have little children playing nearby a church. This is also a facet of our cultural identity, because the church, you know, it's Christian. This is a symbol of Macau, and it creates a different identity, sense of identity in the children. So we feel like this is fundamental in the future, like they say in China, for the global community, shared global community, that more communities are in contact and that they understand each other and that they learn with each other all the characteristics with all their different characteristics, to have a better vision of the world, a more profound vision of the world, and a better understanding within each other. So you live in Macau for 30 years, I think the same time that I live. You also had the contact with Henrique Tenas Fernandes, right? This very generous person. Both of us as journalists, we used to go and talk to him very frequently so that he would explain to us characteristics from Macau. We used to always go and use him as a reference, right? Because because he was always available. Do you remember when he wrote the romance? Whenever we'd interview him about a romance, he was always. He would always take a little bit longer writing his novels. He would always take his time. Could you tell us what is your experience as a journalist, you know, talking with Henrique Tenas Fernandes? First of all, I would like to talk not just as a journalist, but as a person, because Dr. Henrique Tenas Fernandes, there was a lot of coincidences that showed up between us. It started on the 14th of September in 1990. One time, I did a trip with Henrique Tenas Fernandes, and there was a stopover in Lisbon. And we went on the same plane. He ended up staying in London, but then I went back to Macau. For the first time, I was Carlos Marreiros introduced me. Carlos Marreiros introduced me to Henrique Tenas Fernandes, and I met him in the check-in line. He was super nice to me, and he looked me up and down, and he said, you look like you're going to have a good experience in Macau. And I didn't really understand anything about Macau, so Carlos Marreiros, the architect Carlos Marreiros, had told me, talked to me about his book, that this was a writer, Henrique Tenas Fernandes, the one that had wrote O Amor de Dinhos. And I used to think that's a little bit strange, this title of the book, but it stayed in my mind. So I continued with my trip. I got the ferry terminal, the old terminal. While my trip, there was a very beautiful Chinese lady, and she took her shoes off and she put her foot on the front seat. Her feet were very beautiful, very delicate feet, but I thought it was weird that somebody had taken their shoes off and put their foot. And then I remembered the Amor de Dinhos. His book, and I just made a connection. Does it have to do with that? Is it a cultural reference? This is just a funny story, but as I got to know him better, my admiration for him grew. I had a lot of contact with him. There's a lot of private stories, things that I'm not going to talk about between us. But it seems like, you know, 20 years after coming to Macau, I saw him in the school Dom José da Costa Nunes, Portuguese school here. He was sick at the time, and he tried to talk to me, but he couldn't really talk to me like before. And I realized that was the last time I would talk to him, the last days, his last days. He always told me that I had a home in Macau. He always welcomed me here. And he always reminded me to write about Macau, good words about Macau. And he always told me that I should dedicate myself to Macau. It's so hard to talk about Henriquecena Fernandes because we always wanted to have had more of him. He was such an interesting person. Obviously, I wish that I would have taken more advantage of my time with him. I wish I had talked more with him and hang out more with him. I had many opportunities to be with him, but now his works were very important. His works gather a lot of concepts of the presence of the Portuguese in Macau. Basically, I would talk about three concepts: kindness, acceptance of the destiny, and love. He had a view to look at the world, that it was a very kind way to look at the world. It's a very it's a look that is very wanting, but very kind as well. His signature was this kind way to describe things. He had very kind way to look at things, and he accepted destiny. This is very interesting about him, as someone had mentioned about him. The feminine figures to him were very important, but they always had defects. They were never perfect. But he always accepted the defects of a woman, and he always had a positive outlook, and he always transformed everything as a beautiful flower, and a wanting, beautiful flower that discovers itself and opens up with better capacities and will to overcome obstacles in life. And this is one of the best facets about him. Upon any bad luck in life, he always looked at the brighter side. I feel like he writes about the capacity of falling down, but then getting back up. Someone who's alone in the world, but ended up succeeding. I feel like his works, they show a way of being of the Portuguese people. This is something that brings us together, that even with the distance, this is something in our origin, that the Portuguese people bring from Portugal this desire of loving, of wanting, and the destiny, and the fatality. All of these characteristics I can find in his works. I think that these are his most important feats, and definitely one of the biggest feats in the literature world. I also consider the Mekanese community as an exile culture. I think that's all. We have a picture of this very unique society, and we can see this in the works of Miguel. Thank you very much, Carlos. Now we're going to get questions from the public, but first than that, I had asked Carlos. This has to do with Henrique's works. What is the importance that you give at the time that you were president of the Cultural Institute, or you were about to be? What was the importance that you give of the publishing of his works? What's the importance? Thank you very much. His first work, when he published his first work, I was not president of the Institute, but I was working there in 1986. Contra-Almirante Mário Guerra was the governor at the time, and he did not like Henriquecena Fernandes. So he had other political interests, and He did not like Henrique Sena Fernandes. And Henrique Sena Fernandes said, oh, because of that, I don't think they're going to help me be published. But I told him, yes, I'm going to help you. And I'm going to do a cover for your book, and they're going to publish you. Between 89 and 92, we edited The Bewitching Braid, and we did the movie. The Chai Brothers of Shanghai, they loved that book, and they ended up doing a movie about it. This was when Henrique Sena Fernandes was very, very happy. A year and a half before, I also got a lot of criticism at that time because we financed 6 million of patacas for that, and there was a lot of money, and people thought that it was not called for to finance that sort of money. But I ended up going forward with that. It was a great movie, but Henrique Sena Fernandes didn't like that because of the names of the actors. They did not pronounce the names, the names of his characters in the movie. They did not respect the way the patois of Macau. Once we were in the restaurant of Porto Interior with a lot of distinguished people with us, Dr. Eduardo Lourenço as well, and José Saramago was also present. I introduced all of them. We were chit-chatting. And then Henrique Sena Fernandes told me that how come these people don't talk to me? And then they said, and then I told him, no, they are just shy like you. But Henrique Sena Fernandes was a little bit sad that they didn't know him because he considered himself as a proud Portuguese. When he published The Bewitching Braid, he was very, very happy.
A grande maioria é analfabeta. Portanto, os que vão ler os livros, os seus livros são muito poucos. Agora, ao tempo, só Cantão tinha 14 milhões de habitantes e o nível de literacia era inferior ao de Portugal. Portanto, se for conhecido em Cantão, como foi em Guangzhou?
He was well known in Guangzhou. This would have been at least 4 or 5 million. Well, I'm not going to tell more stories about him. I'm going to talk about something very serious. For me,
about Humberto Eco.
Humberto Eco.
I really love Humberto Eco.
I really love him.
The stories that he talked about.
The stories that he talked about.
He talks about architecture.
He talks about architecture and technological.
Henrique also talks
about these topics.
Not talking about Cicero,
but talking about the passage of humanity and the passage of architect, the customs, the women in the Cheongsam, and also the film that we saw, the way that the dress fitted on the women, the way the neck of the dress was high, and they had to keep a posture. They were not able to lower their head.
A lot of his words
talked about the details. And like Fernando Pessoa, who talked about his rivers in his town, in Macau we don't have a river. But we have Henrique de Sena Fernandes, and because he's from my land, he's the best writer. We will now hand over the questions to the audience. If you have anything you would like to ask our distinguished guests. Well, it seems like we don't have any questions. We'd like to say thank you to our distinguished guests today. It seems like you covered all the important topics.
Thank you so much for your collaboration in all this project and for being with us here today, last year,
for being
with our festival, and I hope
for being us in the last
here today and last year.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
David, do you have any last words for us? Something talking about the festival or other?
Thank you so much for your kindness. Your
thank you so much for your kindness and your presence and inspiring us. Also, thank you for inviting me to participate also in this literary festival that you were still able to organize despite the pandemic and all the difficulties that we're experiencing at this moment. A big congratulations, and it was a pleasure. And it was a great honor for me as well to participate and also to help out.
The works of
and also to talk more about the works of Henrik Stenders van Mendes. Thank you so much. Carlos, you wrote the preface of the Chronicles de Sexto, one of the books of the from also Henrik Stenders van Mendes. I'm going to talk about the preface here.
That the humor is
the human tears.
The humor is amazing.
The humor is amazing and makes me cry. It's a storytelling of history.
How do you see
Henrik Stenders van Mendes as a storyteller?
There's a certain
continuity with his father. I had no worries at all, because this narrative is very Macanese. It talks about the present. The books of Henrik talked mostly about a Macau in a time that doesn't exist anymore, the years of the 60s and etc. But Miguel talks more about things more modern and the stories that take place now. Not all of them, but most of his stories take place in more recent years. And it also gives us a vision of the city of Macau of today. And it's sort of a continuation.
I'm always telling Miguel,
you need to publish more works. Also about the Macanese that are in the diaspora living abroad.
You have the responsibility
to carry on the legacy. But this is also to keep alive this narrative, this real narrative. He doesn't have the exact same literary style as his father, which is good, because it's good to have
a fresh perspective.
But you could say they have a similar... There's a fundamental similarity, which is their love for Macau.
And
they have the same background. Macau is a city. The same destiny.
The question of destiny
and the acceptance of destiny. And the possibility of life and how to create this life. And this is so important for isolated communities. because this literature from Macau is growing, and it has its origin in these communities that are obviously have their roots interlinked with other cultures. And this is the source of its great richness, as we can say. And also in the future, we hope that all of us can, we can all be from hybrid cultures. And we can also be considered of other cultures.
I recommend everybody to read.
I would recommend for everyone to read Miguel's book. In Miguel's case, beyond the topics of Macau and his and stories, a more universal theme, you can say. It's we have to remember that we live in a world that is very shared. And our worries are more global
than the worries that we had,
than the worries that we had in the past. In the book of Miguel,
I found some things in Miguel's book
that
don't have only to do with the Macau society.
That don't happen only within the Macau society. So Miguel, I really enjoyed your book.
There's
some points
that left me
that impressed me.
I think it would make an amazing movie.
I think your book would make a fantastic movie. And it would be easily translated to the big screen, because they're really stories with great characters, unique characters that could not exist anywhere else except in these pages and in this city and in your imagination. So I want to extend a big congratulations for your book.
And it was an honor to write a preface. It was an honor to write a preface. It was an honor to write a preface.
And also for writing the preface. Thank you so much for also being present here in this session, and Carlos, in the preface, you talk about the poetry that's needed to tell these stories. It's this impulse, and can you tell us a little bit about this idea?
What is behind
the storytelling
facet of you?
Before I say anything more,
I would like to say how happy I am.
I would really like to express my happiness and how honored I feel. And having have a preface by Carlos Moraes.
Because he's an author with a very original author.
Because he's a very original author with characteristics that are very strong. So really a big thank you to Carlos for your words. Thank you.
Going back to the question,
I want to use one word, arroz.
I feel really.
I feel that all of us are proud,
that we are all very creative.
And we're creative. And we assume I assume myself as a creative. It's not something that happens overnight.
In my
case, it took me a while
to develop this characteristic,
to also develop my creativity so I would be able to even get to the point where I could publish something. I remember a interview that I gave in 2012. And it was the second year after the passing of my father. And I took part in this interview. At this time, I had already talked about
I had some stories,
my Christmas stories that were planned to be published.
I had naturally I kept like.
And they kept being postponed. It was
like,
some.
I was too relaxed.
I was too relaxed, and I put it off. But I really want to thank Ricardo Pinto for this, because when he spoke about the launching of the project for the English translation of Enrique Sender Fernandez, I decided to also hike a ride onto this. I said, oh, Ricardo, maybe I can also put some of my words, some part of my work into it. I can contribute to this project. So I really want to thank him for this opportunity. This is an opportunity that must be. It's something very caring, and it really gives me the motivation to create more. This is very important. The fact that if something is good, the public is the best judge. It's not us that's the best judge of our own work. The moment that we publish something, it's up to the public, and we have no right to intervene with it. So I truly hope that people enjoy it. And when this happens, we have to take care of this opportunity, because it's these opportunities that really launch careers. And we talk about the literature of Macau. I think it's super important that we have these type of projects and giving opportunity to writers, local writers. There's a lot of people that I personally know that they write, and they have a narrative, and they have a storytelling ability, but they're missing something. Maybe they're missing an opportunity, and they're missing that sort of feeling of now, let's do it. I'm going to launch it. I'm going to make it happen. So this is something that can push you forward, and that's what happened to me. So I want to say thank you to Ricardo at this moment. But this really made use of the internet, because the stories were first published on my blog with a lot of regularity. In the beginning, it wasn't something serious. I didn't reach the level of regularity that I wanted to, but now it's here, it's published, and I feel very proud of it. And I just want to say thank you to my public. Thank you very much, Miguel. The book is organized in chronicle order, so we're waiting for the next one. Macau in the time of pandemic. And we're hoping that this book can make a link between your books and also the plays, because this is really something that's for all the Macanese community. So this is a brief presentation of the book from Miguel Sena Fernandes, which has a preface by Carlos, and from these wonderful stories. And we hope that it can be well read and well shared among all of us. We're going to close this edition of the Macau Literary Festival. It was obviously a lot shorter than it normally is, and mostly with authors from Macau. And we're hoping that next year we can continue to have more writers from all around the world, similar to what we had in years past.
Bringing writers from all over the world. But
as you know, until March, nothing has changed. Nothing is going to change in a marked way. So we just want to say thank you all for your presence and your support.